This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Behind the Headlines is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Eric Barnes, publisher of the Memphis Daily News, and welcome to a special edition of Behind the Headlines. This week, we're going to look back at some of the most important stories of the year with our panel of journalists. First, let me introduce our panel. Bill Dries, Memphis Daily News. Wes Smith, Fox 13 News. Amos Maki from the Commercial Appeal. And Jackson Baker from the Memphis Flyer. Welcome, everyone. We're going to start with you, Bill. What was your major, the biggest story of the year, looking back at 2010?
I picked something a bit more gradual than something that happened on a given day. I think that what we saw this year was more than ever that the map of Memphis, so to speak, is remaking itself. And by map, I mean the places that we choose to live versus the places where some of us have to live. We saw the latest of the city's public housing projects fall and be rebuilt as a mixed-use development. Dixie Park is now, Dixie Homes is now Legends Park on the stretch of Poplar Avenue near the new Methodist Le Bonheur Hospital. A very significant development there. We also saw probably the most anticipated government project of the year in Memphis wasn't a structure of any kind. It was the Memphis Shelby Farms Green Line, which had throngs of Memphians using it even before the formal opening of it. And we have two other trails and green lines that are on the way that have mm-hmm. opened since, which have really turned our city from a place of buildings and streets that run by those buildings into something quite different that's still evolving at this point.
Well, and you had the Wolf River Conservancy bought a big chunk of land that's in the really in East Memphis, but a big chunk was given to it.
By Boyle.
There's great big plans for Shelby County, the Shelby Farms transformation of that park. More, you know, people clamoring, where is this green line and where are the new trails? And, you know, also a map kind of change was Tiger Lane, which was really one of those projects that we talked about on the show. It was on time. It was done on time. It was done on budget. It in some ways exceeded expectations. It made people feel like, oh, wow, you can do a simple project that has a real ringing impact.
Right. And simple is the thing here. You know, if you remember all the talk about what the pyramid was going to be the answer to all of our problems. And once it was built, we were all going to get along and people were going to look at us in a new way. And no project can deliver on that. So I think in some ways our expectations are more realistic. But as we've become more realistic, we've seen more possibilities for what our city can do and what our city is, in fact.
Well, and you mentioned the pyramid. You know, there's a plan now, at least. You can't say it's done in 2010, but there's it seems to be forward progress on transforming the pyramid into the Bass Pro Shop and really making a kind of outdoor mall in that area in the whole Pinch District, which would, you know, certainly transform that end of downtown. And I'd also say that Pinnacle Airlines coming downtown and their announcement is one of those things that really will transform a part of downtown, a big building, a big structure on the skyline.
And the Wharton administration has made a point of pushing developments in other areas of the city so that this isn't quite so downtown-centric.
Yeah, but the thing is that skepticism is always so close to the surface when it comes to Memphis and construction projects. For instance, if this pyramid thing in Bass Pro were to bog down, if there is more money spent and outlaid than had been proposed, then you drop back into that whole negative thing again. But as Bill alluded to, these small things build our confidence. They make us say, hey, okay, this is, we don't have to impress the world we can just do good things for our people.
This is for us.
And this is for us. It's not for the world. It's not for the nation. And, you know, you can't find your identity in a building or whatever. But, again, if we can get away from that skepticism that is so close to the surface here and do these things and knock them off one, two, three in a row.
And it is, it's the low budget projects, the green lines. I mean, that's almost as simple as it gets, you know, rails to trails, yeah. Or converting another thoroughfare. There's a greenway. And it's almost an intimate thing because it runs through neighborhoods. It's near your house. You can walk out your door with your kid or your dog and go down and have a nice, relaxing walk. And I think that's one thing that's so important for people for these projects. I mean, this is something right out their front door, and it'll be there forever.
And it's making virtue of necessity because, I mean, the Green Line, that's where the old CSX railroad was. Well, they abandoned that site, so we've got something in its place. It's a re-greening, not a greening.
That's right.
Our next story, Les, what was your story for the year?
My story for the year is the continuing saga of the West Memphis Three, which has now gone on for 17 years since the murder of those three young boys, 8-year-old Cub Scouts in West Memphis. And of course, three people dubbed the West Memphis Three who were convicted and sentenced as their killers, Damien Echols, Jesse Miss Kelly, and Jason Baldwin, all who are now men in their 30s, mid-30s. They were youngsters, teens at that time. But since that time, for the 16 years since their conviction, there has always been people who have said, it was a rush to judgment, it was a rush to judgment. That built up like an avalanche, a momentum. And in this year, and in October of this year, it all came to a head of the Arkansas Supreme Court, a place that earlier had turned down an appeal by Damien Echols, who was on death row, one of the three serving, who the Supreme Court said they were not going to give him a retrial. But then, backed by the money, the power of celebrity, all these things led to this moment in October when the attorney for Damien Echols, Dennis Reardon, came before the Arkansas Supreme Court not to argue for a retrial, but to argue for an evidentiary hearing to introduce new evidence, including DNA. We were there that day, a very monumental day in this case, and this is the way that it went. Even before dawn broke on a chilly Thursday morning, they were gathering, the horde of media, the curious, the sympathetic, the newly converted, and the die-hard faithful reverently standing single file, waiting to enter through the doors of the Arkansas Supreme Court in Little Rock. All wanting to see for themselves if this day would mark a major turning point in the 17-year-old case of the West Memphis Three, and in particular, the fate of convicted death row inmate Damien Echols.
But he's got it the worst. Death row is like unbelievable. He hasn't seen sunlight in 5 or 6 years. They feed him garbage food, so his health is failing fast, so we got to get him out of there ASAP.
New eyes, new ears will hear the facts and the truth, and that justice will be brought out. Justice for six families, freedom for three. That's what I'm here for.
Minutes after court convened at 9 a.m., the seven justices appeared fully enwrapped in the legal presentation of Echols' attorney, Dennis Reardon. Reardon told the court that DNA testing conducted after Echols' conviction did not place him at the scene of the murders. He also cited the contradictory statements of the confession made to West Memphis investigators in 1993 by another convicted in the case, Jesse Miss Kelly. In what appeared to be a strategy that may have made the justices more receptive to his 20-minute oral argument, Reardon shrewdly emphasized the importance of the court granting a new evidentiary hearing in Crittenden County Circuit Court over a decision in favor of a retrial.
Just of a lot of the questions, is that the appropriate remedy? And obviously we'd like to get to a new trial as quickly as possible, but there are sound legal reasons why the court may feel that the appropriate remedy is an evidentiary hearing.
Justices appeared far more skeptical of explanations made by Arkansas Assistant Attorney General David Ropp as to why a new trial or evidentiary hearing shouldn't be held. At one point, one justice asked Ropp point blank if after 17 years, what harm would it do to introduce all evidence of the case, new or old? After the 54-minute proceeding ended, West Memphis 3 supporters felt buoyant about what had transpired and hopeful the justice's decision will be in favor of Echols.
I think the judges actually are doing their jobs, and they're considering the evidence and they're considering the law. And so, yes, it was actually very interesting, very intense, but I feel like we're finally beginning to see justice in this case.
A day that began in darkness would climax in sunshine as a state capitol demonstration of support for the convicted three was held with a colorful city block-long poster made up of thousands of postcards sent from around the world in support of Echols, Miss Kelly, and Jason Baldwin. Though Echols was not allowed to attend the hearing, his optimistic wife knew the message she planned to carry to him.
I would tell him that I think our prayers are about ready to be answered.
Les Smith, Fox 13 News.
3.5 weeks later, those prayers were answered as the Arkansas Supreme Court ruled that the Crittenden County Circuit Court should have an evidentiary hearing. A new judge has been appointed in that case. And so the saga goes on, and maybe with all kinds of twists to come next year.
Well, we leave that there for now. Amos, you're next. What was your story of the year?
For me, it would have been following the city's general services division, the gift that keeps on giving for people like myself. It's a division of city
government. Story that writes itself?
Yeah, sometimes. It's a division of city government. It's responsible for the city's fleet of vehicles, maintaining city facilities. And over the last year, it has become synonymous with inept and possibly corrupt government. We've had 12 officials who have been fired or resigned while under investigation. We had two more indicted recently for theft from their shop. They were stealing metal. The FBI, there's an ongoing FBI investigation into one of these contracts, and it almost became, it became bigger than itself. I would see this all of the time in the consolidation debate. I would get on the internet, read our stories, and read in the comments, and you would see people post, oh, who wouldn't want to be part of Memphis government, where you have all of these folks who are accused of stealing from the city, getting fired. It was just a complete disaster. There was no inventory system. There was nepotism. You have managers with their close family members working under them. So
you had, my favorite part was the check cashing of some $180,000 at a liquor store.
And that was all that we know about for sure. And you're talking about hundreds of thousands of dollars cashed at a liquor store, which makes a paper trail more difficult to follow because now you're dealing in all cash. It's really breathtaking. It's one of the things that confronted Mayor Wharton as soon as he got into office, and he has acted swiftly and in some cases severely with the folks who are in control there.
Well, and that brings up a point that you know, you talk about the pyramid, or you talk about this legacy of skepticism. Mm. You know, there is the optimistic view that this happened. It happened in a prior administration, really started in a prior administration, in the Harrington's administration, and Wharton has jumped on it. And say what you will, he is trying to clean house there, and he's trying to bring these people either to justice or at least be held accountable, and hopefully, you know, I think for most taxpayers, hopefully setting a tone that this kind of stuff can't be.
Those people are gone now. The people who were in charge while that division was basically falling apart, and you had guys running roughshod over it, they're gone now. They're gone. We don't have to worry about them anymore.
And the reason this is important, even to the most skeptical Memphian, is not just that it's unethical behavior. There's a more practical reason. The skepticism that these kind of scandals engender make it much more difficult for those government leaders who come later to pursue worthy projects, because it raises questions about, okay, you couldn't change a tire on a police car without some fraud involved. How are you going to move this city forward if you can't do that?
And it goes back to consolidation. I mean, I really do think that was one of the biggest enemies of consolidation, was all the skepticism that the county folks who are opposed to consolidation had about the ability of the city of Memphis to function.
And they would say, we don't want to be run by
and
that.
It reflects
we don't want to be associated
with
that in any way.
It's a valid point.
It is.
It's a valid point.
It is.
Mm-hmm.
No one wants to be ripped off or feel like, I mean, you had one guy who was ordering flat screen TVs and parts for his Escalade through city contracts. And then he goes out and gets a DUI in a city vehicle.
Right.
And no one wants to be associated with that.
Yeah. Well, and you know, you even look at things like Otis Jackson, who was the General Sessions Court clerk, who is in trouble now for allegations of abusive ethical violations. And I made the point that, you know, perhaps those employees in the court clerk's office who came forward to tell on him may not have done that if General Sessions hadn't, or if General Services hadn't played out the way it had, where you create this idea that you as an employee can come forward and the higher-ups will be held accountable.
Right? Yeah, one tendency among elected leaders is to look at something like this and say, we need more guidelines in place. Important thing to remember, there were plenty of guidelines in General Services. No one was following them, and no one was making them follow them.
Right.
All right, we move on to Jackson, your story of the year.
No question it was the election year itself, the series of elections. And I really want to back up to 2008 by prefacing that, because that was the year of the Obama landslide nationally. But Tennessee was already showing signs of Republicanizing itself. I had a conversation with John Ryder, who is Mr. Republican around here, who is in charge of national redistricting for Republicans, the Memphis lawyer. And we agreed that if Hillary Clinton had somehow won the Democratic nomination, she would have been able to hold a lot of these southern states within the Democratic orbit that have shifted out. Obama never had a standing in the South except for in the inner cities, various places. The old white establishment went their separate way, either into impotence or into affiliation with the Republican Party. What we saw with this year in a nutshell was the continued decline of the Democratic Party, not only statewide, enormously so, but locally. Even the most recent vestige of that, when we had a special school board election with Sarah Lewis running against Cherry Davis, who was vice chair of the local Democratic Party, spent an important cadre of Democratic Party for years. She couldn't muster enough organization out of that to win her election. Democratic Party has fallen on evil times. They have the Democrats in theory have the majority in Shelby County, but they were unable to win a single seat among the contested races and countywide offices. And of course, statewide, it was a wipe out of Democrats. Local legislators who are Democrats held their own this year, but not for long. Some of those are going to be redistricted out too. So that's the main story, is Tennessee has shifted over and Shelby County is going with it to the Republican orbit.
I think locally, the problem is that Democrats don't have a unified message. Unlike you take the election of Luttrell and all these guys, the nine different offices they won, there was unity there. Behind those early voters who came out, the thousands of them, they were unified. They knew what they wanted to do. They knew they had support. So all Luttrell had to do was talk about issues. He didn't have to establish himself as different or personality or anything else. He had the issues. His supporters knew what those issues are and whatever. Democrats locally didn't have that guidance. They didn't have that. They were all fragmented. Even though they tried to attempt to run as one and one block you, take us all or whatever, I remember very, very vividly one politician saying, well, you know, just hold your nose and vote for them anyway because they're Democrats.
That's true. You can't win. Who's the coordinator
like
of the campaign?
Right. You can't win like that.
And it was also the day after the primaries that this happened. So that kind of tainted the whole campaign. I don't think what we saw locally was an indication of a national trend. I think it was an indication of the fact that the Democrats decided to run as a ticket because they saw demographics that they thought favored them, and the ticket had some very good candidates, but they were right next to some candidates who had really no business being on the ballot and had no prospect of winning at all. The other point that I would make is that the county mayor's race might have gone much differently. The reason that Luttrell decided to get into the race was because Harold Byrd, who was eyeing a run in the Democratic primary, was the best bet to be a crossover candidate for either of the two parties, and he decided not to. that was the point at which Luttrell got into the race.
Well, and it, for me, this segues into the idea that, you know, there was this Republican sweep, and there were weaknesses in the local Democratic Party. But Steve Cohen, a Democrat, a liberal Democrat, everything that supposedly couldn't win in, you know, this election season on a national level, destroyed his competition. And, oh, by the way, his competition was Willie Harrington. And for me, when you talk about politics in 2010 on a local level, that was as much as anything the big story, because he was a non-story. It was nothing. He garnered little to no support. Right. It was that era of Harrington really seems to be over, in the sense that he couldn't beat Steve Cohen. He couldn't even be in the same room as
Steve Cohen. Again, you have some of the old organizations becoming impotent, not able to do anything. He had an organization at one point. He was able to win elections. He wore
not too long ago.
Mm-hmm. Right. Right.
And in fact, there was also another aspect of that. Republicans voted for Cohen. They crossed over and voted for Cohen. A measurable number of them did.
Right. Mm-hmm. And last question on one of the many elections this year, we could do a pool on how many elections there actually were. There were somewhere between 4 or 5 or 6 election days. There were irregularities in the August vote. Any ramifications from that? There were some problems with the voting. Do we see anything changing?
No, there were irregularities. There always are, but they were not of the kind that would influence the outcome. That's the courts have established that. And what that furor after the election indicated more than anything else was, again, the fecklessness and inability to influence society of the Democratic Party these days in Shelby County. They got nowhere with that. They got nowhere with the general public, nowhere with the courts.
Yeah, yeah. All right. Our last part here, we're going to do, this is our first year doing the show, we're going to do predictions of what will happen in 2011. I remind everyone that we are being recorded, and this will be on the Internet. So I'll start with you, Bill. What do you see coming? What predictions do you have for the year ahead?
2011, of course, is an election year for city elections.
It's always an election year in Memphis.
It's always. We have had an election year via special or regularly scheduled elections for over a decade now. We haven't had an off election year in that long, at least. But I'm going to leave that to others, and I'll chime in on that as the case may be. I'm going to say that the Bass Pro development will be launched this year, that we'll see the Seeding Bowl come out of the pyramid, and that we will see Bass Pro's plans move forward in a rather harsh economic climate, remaining in a recession. And I think as a result, while the Bass Pro development will move forward, it will be limited in its scope to a degree that it will force the overarching plans to change a great deal.
So no, you don't think the Pinch District redevelopment will happen?
I think the Pinch District will struggle and might be smaller in scope than what they are originally envisioning.
Amos?
I would say there's several things. I would say next year we'll figure out how the city will pay Memphis City Schools a one-time payment. We owe them, the court said, $57 million from the council, cut the money in 2008. We're still dealing with it now. I think we'll have some kind of resolution to that in the coming year. What else? Mayor Wharton. I think Mayor Wharton will do well. He'll win re-election. Yeah. And I don't think we'll hear much from Willie Harrington. That's another prediction.
I'm saying $47 million on the schools.
47.
By my math, it's halfway between $57 million and $30 million. Lump sum.
I think that despite the fact that you have this newly configured Republican domination of the Tennessee legislature, you're not going to see any of the wild stuff you saw in the previous two general assemblies. In fact, I don't think there will be a bill requiring you to take a gun to your pew in church. I think they're through that for a while. I think things will settle down. In fact, I think what you will see is, now that the Republican Party has achieved such domination, you'll see the same distribution between liberals, moderates, and conservatives in that party as you always saw in the old Democratic Party when it was the only party in the South.
Hmm. Less.
My predictions go the exact opposite of both of you gentlemen. Because I believe that the Tennessee General Assembly will pass one of the stiffest immigration laws in the nation. I think it will be over the veto. They will override the veto of Governor Bill Haslam. And this state will be besieged by all types of demonstrations by Hispanics and other groups like that who are have vested interest in these laws, and we are going to be right out there in terms of the attention that's going to be given to this law. My second thing, very short, I don't think we have seen the last of Willie Harrington, because we have not seen the last of Willie. It's going to be in print. The Willie Harrington book, I predict, will come up with some uncomfortable things said about some people. One of those people will be A.C. Wharton. And I think for the first time we will find out whatever happened, what did happen in that infamous Le Chardonnay little meeting they had back in 2007. I think all that's going to come out in his book, and I think there's also going to be some uncomfortable moments. That's not saying that Wharton will be knocked down and will not win the election. Of course he will. But I think there's going to be some things coming out in this book that are going to make him uncomfortable and a lot of other people in this town.
Is there a publication date for this book?
I've heard differing things. you know, of course, he was supposed to have a radio show, too.
There is. I'm diving in on another prediction. No book in 20 years. It will not see the light of day.
Everything is on hold.
He told me I was going to be in the book. I want to see it.
You did my exit interview. I know what happened.
We're going to end it there. My prediction. Transformation of downtown, full pinch district, pinnacle coming. By this time next year, downtown will look or be about to look remarkably different. That's all the time we have tonight. Thank you. Happy New Year to everyone. Happy New Year to you all. Thanks for joining us. I'm Eric Barnes, Memphis Daily News. Thanks and good night.